your position, putting the whole thing together, mixing and matching artists together with material. What's your impression of how things went?
Rehearsals were awesome. They were amazing. And it was 2 days of rehearsals, pretty much nonstop. And I wish it was 5 days. I wish it was Monday through Friday. And if some people want to come back and hit it again, they could. You know, it's a lot of fun. It's when the camaraderie really, you know, everybody starts to feel that. Like some of us were talking about when we were playing and rehearsing these songs, we had chills. Because, and then you start going, imagine, you know, them at that time at Woodstock playing, you know, listening to you or whatever. It's just like how heavy duty it was. So the rehearsals were amazing. The drum kit, everybody's sitting down having a great time. The bass rig's insane. The singers are great. All the musicians involved are killing. Everybody's, you know, a Who fan, you know? So, you know, it's just really cool when it comes together like this.
Up a little bit. In case you don't know why you're here tonight, we are here in honor of John Entwistle and Keith Moon, famously known as the greatest rhythm section in the world. Our fearless leader, Mr. Brian Tichy, is going to come out and introduce a couple of guys. We got a big night for you. A lot of great stars coming out. Hey, Brian. Ox and the Loon, what do you think?
Just got back from the Isle of Wight. Doug, thank you for coming. It's going to be insanity. Just give a big round of applause for everybody that's about to come up. And mainly for John Emerson and Keith Moon. Come on, oh my God.
Chest, the way daddy comes home, never gets no rest, but she's playing all night, and the music's alright. My mama's gotta squeeze, my daddy never sleeps at night.
Well, hopefully you're not all getting radiation burn from my head. I'm here with Rikki Rockett, who's like got the opposite hairdo as I do. How are you, Rikki?
Well, I'm doing good. I'm doing good.
Yep. Backstage, upstairs, three flights after pounding out Squeeze Box, and the kids are already sounding great.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. I had a lot of fun. You know, I was saying earlier, my meter couldn't be bad because I had Sean McNabb just like going.
Right there in the groove.
Yeah, he was in.
But what was cool wasn't that the essence of how Keith played? You know, he had Pete doing the rhythm, he had the ox right there holding the groove down like rivets, and he was able to just sort of float through all that stuff, you know?
You know what? It's like I was saying earlier, the Who wasn't just musical composition, okay? And I was talking to the estate people. You know, sometimes when Keith was hitting drums, he was telling somebody else to shut up. That's what he was doing. Yeah. And Entwistle would do something, and he was telling him to shut up. And, you know, there was like, I know this because our band operates very similar.
Does it work for you?
Oh, yeah. Well, it definitely keeps it reckless. So.
Right there on the edge, yeah.
Yes.
We'll be right back.
Hey everybody, Dan Schinder here on Drum Talk TV with Ashley Austin from Artist Legacy Group, who handles the Keith Moon Estate. How are you?
I'm very well. How are you?
Wonderful, and it's a pleasure to be with you. As you know, we've done a documentary on this whole event. What do you think about all of this, being from your perspective, you know, with working with the estate?
For me, as a legacy and brand manager, you know, Keith is an icon. You know, it's amazing to see just how many amazingly talented musicians he has inspired, and the fact that they're all taking the time out of their crazy busy schedules to come out and celebrate him, you know, all at once here in this amazing space at the House of Blues, like, I couldn't ask for anything more. And, you know, the estate and Artist Legacy Group is so excited to be a part of this.
All the musicians involved, we've talked to all of them throughout practice arriving today. They are so psyched. It's not like it's just another gig. It's definitely something very special to, like you said, celebrate someone that's very special, that's left a huge footprint in the music business. He's still influencing people that were born like 15, 20 years ago, which is incredible. Talk a little bit more about what Artist Legacy Group does so people understand your position, so they understand your perspective a little bit more.
We are estate managers primarily, and, you know, when an icon passes away, the music doesn't stop necessarily. There's still a lot that can be done with a legacy in terms of very cool projects and just reinvigorating their name and likeness in new and interesting ways. So that's, you know, that's what we're doing with Keith, and merchandise, films, instruments. So there's a lot of exciting stuff coming that you'll hear more about in the coming months.
Is there a link that we can put on the screen where people can go and keep up to date with those things that are being released through the group?
Sure. Keithmoon.com, artistlegacygroup.com, Keith's Facebook page.
Right here.
Which is facebook.com Keith Moon Official. He also has a Twitter, twitter.com/Keith Moon.
Great. Awesome. Because I know people will want to keep up to date. You might know Steven from Fine Frenzy, a pop group that he was with for a while. He was also the keyboardist for the Jason Bonham Led Zeppelin Experience. He's been in the Bonzo Bash performances, which have, by this time, there's been many. Yeah, and Randy Rhoads remembered for the first time ever this past January 2014, and now the Ox and the Loon. How's it going, man?
It's going great.
The rehearsals were awesome.
Yeah, oh, thank you. It was really, everything came together really quickly. Not a whole lot of playing it over and over again. It was just, yeah. I think we all love this music.
You know? Yeah, exactly. And you play on about 70 to 80% of the tunes, too, which is great.
Keyboards, Pete played a lot of keyboards.
Yeah, absolutely. What's your favorite aspect of, if you look at the arc of all the music you're going to play from the Who's catalog, is there a notch in that arc that you're looking forward to the most tonight? I know you're really excited about the show.
With Tommy, that really changed music, I thought, in a lot of ways. You know, this kid writing about, not about love or some girl he wants or something like that, but about life. And yeah, I thought that was really great.
Dave's gonna tell you a little something about Keith Moon.
Alright, check this out. I wasn't really into Keith Moon. Don't say boo or anything. It's just I kind of skipped him. After Bonham, I call him a lost him. I bought Who Are You? And then that was it. But then when Brian hit me up for this gig, I had to research on Keith Moon. I had to watch his style, you know. Just kind of make little key points. And man, this guy blew me away. He has the chaos mentality of a metal or punk drummer, which I think Keith Moon, he was. Although they were kind of mod. I don't know if that was right, you know? They're kind of a mod kind of group. But they were, definitely Keith Moon had the attitude of a punk rocker or a metalhead. So he definitely inspired me. And who knows, I might start playing his style sometimes, but okay, thanks, man. Thanks for having me, Brian. Thank you.
He could have fooled me, man. I mean, listen to David Slayer, he is just complete chaos control. And I'm watching him, and I'm like, this makes perfect sense to me. I think he's lying. I think he grew up and he slept and breathed, Keith, because that's amazing. I loved it, Dave. You rule.
Thank you. Thank you.
guys, we got something special we're going to do now. Got to become a tradition with Brian and I when we do these shows every now and then. Want to give a special acknowledgement to some of the founders and the people that taught everyone else, inspired everyone else to learn how to play the bass and learn how to play the guitar and the drums and singers every now and then. I want to bring out a good friend of the Who's who was with them for over 40 years. John Entwistle's personal manager and best friends when they were kids. Please welcome to the stage Mr. Cy Langston.
Themselves or not. I can't fucking hear you. I still can't fucking hear you. Welcome, welcome. I'm not going to stand up here yakking too long because the show must go on and it's the music you're here for. So, come
on. I'm going to give him a hint real quick, Si. Just a little hint, then I'm going to let you tell a story. We do have a bit of a surprise. What we're going to do tonight is present the very first John Entwistle Bass Legends Award. And having Cy here, who was John's closest friend for years and years, we had a conference on this and decide who we were going to give this award to. You guys aren't going to believe this. And we came up with one choice only for the very first John Entwistle Award. And I'm going to give him a little hint. Started out in a band called the Rainmakers. And then he went on the road with Jimi Hendrix doing a little fucking guitar teching. Then a little band called Hawkwind.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Lemmy Cummins.
Fucking Lemmy. All right, let me say a few words. Here it is, the John Entwistle Bass Legends Award for Lemmy.
Thank you, and thank you. I actually knew John Anke for a long time, you know. I only went drinking with Keith once, that's usually enough. I've been drinking with John a whole lot, and that guy should still be alive, but something killed him, it's probably his conscience. So anyway, thank you very much, everybody. See you again.
Lemmy, thank you for all your years of changing the face of music forever. The John Entwistle Legends Award.
And I got my own little Lemmy story back in 2006. There was the first ever Dime Bash. It was Dime Bang, Daryl Dime Bash at NAMM. And they called me and said, hey, you come down and jam. And I'm a huge Dime Bang fan and buds with the guys. And that was already an honor just to be a part of it. And then they called me and go, can you do a set on drums with Lemmy? And I'm like, yeah. So we rehearse and they go, no, here's the song, show up and you're playing with Lemmy. I'm like, are you kidding me? You're gonna make me get behind Lemmy and play like 6-7 songs, and that's a little bit of pressure, but you know what, you only live once, so I did it, and we played, and it kind of went okay, I thought. I was like, I just hope he doesn't like say anything really, like, you know, dude, what were you doing back there? That was like really, you confused me, it was annoying, you know, just, but he said, you did a good job, and that's all I needed to hear, and that was a heavy moment, so once again, please give it up for Lemmy. I'm really glad that he made it, stopped by, a true legend.
All right, we got another special surprise for you. In honor of Keith Moon, who we're paying tribute to tonight, we're gonna bring out Ashley Austin. She represents Keith Moon's legacy estate, the Artist Legacy Group. She's gonna come out and talk to you a little bit about Keith and the family real quick.
Mandy, who couldn't be here tonight, unfortunately. We are so grateful to all of you for coming out, to all of the amazing talent and performers who have joined us here tonight. How about a huge round of applause for everybody that has come out this weekend? So thank you all so much, Rock On, Keith Moon, and on behalf of the Estate and Artist Legacy Group, thanks again.
Thank you, Ashley. All right, we got a little surprise now. This one's gonna be good. Hey, Brian. I've got a Legends Award here for a famous drummer.
All that stuff. All right, check this out. This is awesome. We were also talking, okay, you know, we all agreed it's gotta be Lemmy, and that's amazing that he showed up. But of course, we're doing the Ox and the Loon, so it's time to do what we call, what do we call that? The Keith Moon Legend Award, right? It's pretty simple, I think that made sense. So I wanted to write a little bit of stuff and read it about this guy. He's a true legend. So here, let's just start here. He's been recording and touring the world since 1980. He pretty much came out swinging, everyone took notice, and it never stopped. I remember being a 13-year-old kid in 1981, 82, eating up everything about drums, and I took note of his rock-solid groove and his exuberant energy on camera. Then I heard his drum break in a very popular number one single, and I was an instant fan. From that point on, it seemed that he was unstoppable. If you're a drummer, you'll agree, he has not left the public eye for 34 years. He is known for his power, his groove, his ability to jump into all rock styles and make the band sound great. He always comes across as a regular guy that's just real happy to play the drums. But when you look at his career and you see who he's played with, it makes your jaw drop to the ground. Because it's very hard to come across one person that has accomplished this much. All right, let's move on. On a drum side note, he's known for riding his hi-hat with his left hand, although he is a righty. And I remember reading about that when I was a teen and seeing if I could do the same thing. From as far back as 1993, we crossed paths and he was nothing but very kind to me. So through a handful of Bonzo Bashes, emails analyzing drum parts we love, and club jams, I can call him a friend, clearly see why he is one of the most popular and hardworking drummers of all time. He has a positive attitude and a work ethic second to none. If you call him and he gives his word, you know you're getting 100%. Done deal? So right when you think you're working hard enough, just remember there are super talented guys out there like this legend that put 100% into every situation without question. And for him, it's paid off. So on that, let me run through a quick list of artists this legend is toured and recorded with. All right, here we go. John Mellencamp, Tony Iommi, The Smashing Pumpkins, Bob Seger, John Fogerty, Melissa Etheridge, John Bon Jovi, Elton John, Bob Dylan, Rod Stewart, Alanis Morissette, Joe Jackson, The Rolling Stones, Stryper, Michael Sweet, Lynyrd Skynyrd, Cinderella, Willie Nelson, Waylon Jennings, Puddle of Mud, Avril Lavigne, Joe Cocker, B.B. King, Mick Jagger, Ray Charles, Alice Cooper, I'm Halfway Finished, The Modines, Meatloaf, Bonnie Raitt, Ricky Martin, Santana, Trey Anastasio, Michelle Branch, Vince Gill, Leslie West, Gladys Knight, Aaron Neville, Trisha Yearwood, Patti LaBelle, George Jones, Conway Twitty, The Buddy Rich Big Band, Jefferson Airplane, Mary J. McCartney, Johnny Cash, Stevie Nicks, Marshall Crenshaw, Corey Hart, this other guy called Brian Wilson. And even with that list, I have to finish by saying, and many others, he's one of the guys like what Chad Smith can't, you know, do the chicken foot gig, he calls this guy. So also I gotta mention, he was named the number one pop rock drummer and the number one studio drummer for 5 consecutive years by Modern Drummer, by the readers of Modern Drummer, and he's played on over 30 Grammy nominated recordings. Did I forget to tell you he's the guy on the drums at the Kennedy Center Honors when they're honoring Led Zeppelin? Led Zeppelin's watching him, hanging out with President Obama. Okay, I gotta stop there. I gotta get this amazing drummer out here with his unparalleled career. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for a true legend on the drum kit, a man who makes 60 look like 40, a man I hope to someday grow up and be as cool as, the recipient of the first ever Ox & Loon Keith Moon Legend Award, Mr. Teddy Aronoff. Yeah!
Grammy? I had no idea. They say that shit, now I'm really saying it. I had no idea. I'm sitting back here. Brent's going, hey, we gotta talk about the arrangement of a song I'm gonna do. I'm like, why, don't you know it? And he's like, hey, stay right here. I said, I gotta go get somebody. He said, no, stay right here. Anyway, thank you very much.
Awesome. Dude, you deserve it. We all have nothing but insane respect for you. Yeah. Give it up for Kenny one more time. Kenny Aronoff. In 20 years, he's still going to be doing it more and better than all of us.
So I'll do push-ups right now.
Bit of history here. You know, growing up in London, it was very difficult to not know who the Who were. And as a London-based bass player, I grew up listening to bands that had great bass players. There's Andy Fraser and Free, Paul McCartney, the Beatles. Heard of those guys by any chance? Ron Burr, playing with Jet Beck. And of course, John Entwistle. John Entwistle was the guy that changed the way you thought about the bass. He said, you know what, it's not a bass guitar, it's a lead instrument. You can do things, you can break convention, you can do something which is totally different. And he had this sound, this distorted sound, which you've been hearing tonight, we're all trying to emulate. So I found when I was younger, I could go home to my dad's reel-to-reel tape recorder and wire my bass in there. And turn up the gain, and I got this distorted, saturated sound. It was fantastic. It probably sounded like crap, but I was having a great time with it. It was a very, very sad, sad day. The day that my dad's tape recorder died. You know, he kind of pushed the bass tone. And every time I pushed my bass tone and I got it to a point where I thought I was going to do something new, he would come out with another album, and another sound, and another tone. He was constantly pushing the envelope. So that's why we're here tonight. It's the two guys who pushed the envelope so far for all of us, you know? And they paved the way for us to be here tonight.
Thank you.
at the show, during the show, The Ox and the Loon. We've seen the rehearsals and some interviews and everything, and now it's finally just about showtime. You go on in a little bit, play the Tommy Overture, Sparks, and...
Amazing Journey is in between. That leads to Sparks, but yeah, I mean, Tommy is probably one of my favorite albums of all time, one of my biggest influences. I even have the album cover tattooed on my leg.
That's right.
So yeah, I had to play something from Tommy. That album changed my life.
It sounded great at rehearsal, Billy.
Nah, it was just a rehearsal. Tonight will be a real deal.
Yeah,
I was holding back. You know, when you play like Keith, you break a major sweat, so I didn't want to kill it in rehearsal. But right. Tonight I'll go for it.
At rehearsal, there's certainly a camaraderie. It's short. It's only a couple days. And here, even backstage, during the show, there's a lot of camaraderie. Is that one of the favorite things you like to look forward to the Bonzo Bash and now this, the Oxen?
Yeah, I mean, it's the ultimate drum hang. All my fellow drummer bros are here, and everybody's just watching each other and enjoying each other and having a good time. And now for this particular gig, you got a bunch of amazing bass players throwing it to the mix
exactly.
as well.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's a great, great hang.
Now, we've talked a lot about Bonzo and you here. We talked a little bit about Keith Moon when we've done one of your other interviews. But I don't think we covered this. What was the first time you heard Keith that really made an impact on your playing and wanted you to do that workout?
Well, there were two levels to my introduction to Keith. The first was from day one. I mean, literally, when I was 6 months old, I was introduced to them by my dad, because my dad was a big Who fan, and he introduced me to music and rock when I was a kid. So I remember when Tommy came out, I was about 2 years old, and I just couldn't stop listening to Tommy's Holiday Camp, and hearing Smash the Mirror, all the quirky tunes.
Yeah.
So I was listening to Keith and the Who from day one when I was a child. But skip forward to about 79 when I was 11 years old, and I went and saw The Kids Who Are All Right, the movie, and that was the big breakthrough for me. A lot of people talk about when they saw Ringo and Ed Sullivan, that was the pivotal moment. For me, my Ringo and Ed Sullivan moment was actually Keith with The Kids Are All Right. And when I've been listening to The Who since I was a kid, but once I saw Keith play, I was just completely transfixed. I couldn't take my eyes off of him. He was such a personality, and that was the moment where I said, that's what I want to do, and I want to be a drummer like that.
Right. Hey, what do you think of the kit?
Oh, it's amazing. I've done, I had a Who tribute band I put together in 2006, and I had two configurations for that. I had the Tommy, you know, the Woodstock 1970 kit, the black black kit like what we have down there, and then I did one show in Chicago, and Victor Salazar made the big, like, I think it was the Quadrophenia tour kit with the multi-layered,
the white kit.
So I played both of those, but the Pictures of Lily kit is the quintessential Keith kit, so it's really cool that it's here tonight.
Yeah, it's the equivalent of Bonzo's Amber.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Cool. Mike, thanks for joining us. I know you want to hang, watch everybody else. We've got a couple other interviews. I'm sorry I had to drag you up four flights of stairs.
That's all right.
Hey, at least we're in
control. I need a warm-up because tonight's going to kill me. Playing like Keith is like running up 100 flights of stairs. So right. Four flights is nothing.
Exactly. Mike Portnoy here on The Ox and the Loon on DrumTalkTV.com. We'll be right back.
nothing in the world these days. I said a young man, he ain't got nothing in the world these days. You know, in the old days, when a young man was a strong man, all the people, well, they stepped back when a young man walked out. Days, it's the old man who's got all the money, and a young man, he ain't got nothing in the world these days. I said, he ain't got nothing, he got sweet father. Everybody knows.
its wasteland.
Starr, my good bud Matt Starr, for getting this together, making this night even mightier than it already was gonna be. This just puts another big fat cherry on the top. This next person I'm about to introduce is a full-blown legend. He is literally my first guitar hero ever. He is a founding member of one of the biggest rock bands in the world in the heyday, and in the reunion that once again saw them reclaim all their glory. He is responsible for influencing a ridiculous amount of guitar players, and his tasty and creative musicality, whether it be a great solo or a killer riff, should never go unnoticed, as they are just as integral to what made us gravitate to him and become fans for life as is his out of this world image. He was all over my walls as a kid, he still is. I can hum all his solos. His riffs were always the coolest ones on the record. He is an original, an originator, an inventor, a forward thinker, a legend who was part of a band that took it further than anyone else. He created an iconic image that is so unique, there's no category for it, it's just him. The combination of everything he stood for is pretty much, in my eyes, the pinnacle of everything rock and roll stands for. Attitude by the boatload, matched by great musicianship with tone, with a knack for hooks, charisma, a persistence, in excess and survival, and he's still here to talk about it. Let us all get that chance of being able to possibly shake his hand or watch him perform or just be reminded of his mightiness by his presence. I could go on and on about how important his music and image were to me in the beginning of my realization that I'm a lifer behind a kit of drums and also trying to grasp the art of rock guitar. I've covered his songs in tribute records. I've covered his songs live. Last summer, I started a band with Rex from Pantera, Bumblefoot from Guns N' Roses, and Mark Zavon from Kill Devil Hill,
all tributing to his band's music from the 70s. As it kicked our collective asses so hard, we still got excited enough to do it. I'm so beyond sight that he's here now. Here's a couple clues. Parasite, Shock Me, Rip It Out, the funniest member of the band, Tom Snyder's funniest interviewee ever, and a smoking Les Paul. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up to a true legend on guitar, a rock soldier from the planet Chendel, a founding member of KISS, Mr. Ace Frehley.
Thank you. Thank you.
for Stephen Perkins.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
I told you guys it was going to be something spectacular. Let's give it up for John Entwistle and Keith Moon. The Ox and the Loon, all these players that came out for you tonight. Everybody come out and take a bow real quick. When I say three, everybody take a picture. One, two.